front of the room, if you would, the seat of honor. And I think that you know of everyone, but if you don't know someone, please take a minute to be introduced. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
You can sit or stand, whichever you're most comfortable doing. We'd like you to start by telling us why you think you should be a circuit court judge.
This probably sounds repetitive. I believe I would make an excellent circuit court judge. I've worked for the judiciary for the last 22 years as an arm of the court. I've been instrumental in the work product of both the circuit at the circuit court level and at the appellate court level. I think that my work product speaks for itself. The judges I work for have expressed that they highly respect my work. They put me in a position of authority in the court where I'm in charge of 8 of our judicial staff attorneys. That involves not only a supervisory component, but it also involves me taking on an entire workload myself. So I'm quite busy. I think that in my work now as an appellate attorney, I am well suited to a circuit court judge position based on the fact that I am used to finding error, puzzle solving, trying to make the law work for the populace, but also being mindful of following the law. In our job at the appellate court, it's all about getting it right. So I think that I'm at this point in my career where this is sort of the progression that it should take. I think I'm an excellent fit for the job.
Talk to us, if you would, about what part of your background would prepare you to handle busy and crowded dockets and handle a raucous courtroom or party or attorney.
Well, I think anybody who knows me knows that I like the pace. I like the pace of the circuit court level probably more than the appellate court level, although my position in the appellate court involves 2,500 cases per year, managing and moving them and making sure that they're timely, leaving the court, making sure that everybody gets their process, but also making sure that it all moves. So I think I'm well suited to that just as part of my personality and part of my work experience. I'm very used to having a really large docket.
Have you ever had an opposing counsel?
No, I have not been an advocate, but I think that in my position being unique to the fact that I've been the impartial tribunal, which is the court, for the last 22 years, which puts me in a better position to understand that you don't take a position as a judge, that you are to find the correct answer. So I don't think it is a detriment to me.
How would you deal with a situation where two counsels just are not agreed on anything? I mean, in civil, we're fighting over discovery. We're fighting, we've got a motion to dismiss, you're fighting over. Now we're fighting over discovery and motions to compel and deadlines, and then we're fighting at summary judgment level. We are just not seeing eye to eye on anything, including timing issues, setting our hearings.
Right. I'm known to be an excellent mediator as far as getting people to work together. I think I have an innate ability to do so and to get people to at least work together. Maybe not always to see eye to eye. I think that's like an impossibility at times, especially when there's zealous advocacy for a particular point or a particular place in a trial. But I think that based on my personality and on my dealings with 11 judges at the appellate court level, that I'm excellent at working with people and getting them to move in the right direction at the same time. One of my mentors at the circuit court level was Judge James Foxman, and he was the best at that. He was able to get people to really move together in one direction, and I think he was an excellent mentor for me to be able to see that in action and to take on a lot of what he did in the courtroom.
Sarah. More than likely, this position is going to be in the family court division. And doing family law work, you're going to encounter a lot of pro se individuals who are likely not as sophisticated as the judges that you deal with on an everyday basis. How are you going to handle that?
Out of probably the 2,500 cases that we have at the appellate court level, the vast majority in my office are pro se. so I am used to deciphering pro ses, figuring out what they're looking for. Stephen Gosney understands that completely. Yes, in my role at the court, it's been, you know, a large majority of pro ses, so I have absolutely no problem working with pro se people and getting them to move towards what is necessary to the completion of the case. I think I have a unique ability with regards to pro ses.
Yeah, and I'll just share that. And I have lots of questions for you, but not necessarily for you. But I'm interested because, like, you know, to do an Anders, we have to master the record and then send it off. It's sort of
no,
personal,
I understand,
too,
yes.
But how much vetting do you do when you get an Anders brief and you have somebody who raises 30 points on a pro se?
We do a complete review.
I'm sorry.
So Anders actually, you know, obviously, we're allowed to do a shortened memorandum for the judges as far as disposition goes, but we do a complete review. So what appears to be something very short that we do can take a day, 2 days, just to comb through a record to see if there's any reversible error. So I have got my people down to a science of going through every single point in the record.
How many people are assigned to the pro se briefs?
There are 8 of us.
Wow.
So we handle all the pro se, we handle all the original petitions, all the post-conviction, all the members, all the certs.
I got a quick question. What is an Anders brief? I'm not a lawyer.
An Anders brief is where a defendant has been given appointed counsel on appeal, and the appointed counsel, which will either be the public defender or conflict counsel, files a brief that basically gives us some indication of what could have been error, but the reason why it's not error, and then they just say that there's no meritorious issues on appeal. So what we do then is we allow the pro se to file their own brief, which is always an interesting thing in and of itself. And so we decipher what they're looking, you know, to assert, and then we go through the entire record to determine whether or not there's any reversible error, fundamental error.
Because I get a lot of questions from people who after we Anders about how much review does the Fifth actually do on their briefs, and that's kind of I always say, you know, they have an independent review, and that's all I say.
Complete, absolutely complete. There's nothing that gets missed by the people.
Sharon, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
We will let everyone
know. I appreciate it. Nice seeing you all again.
We'll let everyone know by the end of the day today.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.